something that I would argue is as equally important. And there are a few people touched on yesterday. Brian did. I know a couple other people did as well. Their names are escaping me right now. So we're going to talk about maintaining and monitoring ourselves, the ones who are responsible for the code, for these communities, for keeping these things up and running on a regular basis. So a few things I'm going to touch on. First of all, who am I? Why is it important for me to monitor myself? Secondly, it's not all about me. So why is it important for all of us to monitor ourselves? And then lastly, we'll talk about how to take care of ourselves in order to prevent burnout and more about that. So first of all, who am I? I am a community manager and builder, both by trade and by nature. So personally and professionally, I love investing in communities, being involved in communities, getting to know new people. My current position is community manager or advocate at a company called SparkPost. We have a table over there. If you haven't talked to us yet, come over, say hi, learn more about us, and do the raffle for the Raspberry Pi. But in short, we are an email and delivery analytics platform for developers. We have an API you can plug into. It's a lot of fun, a lot of good opportunities to use it. So swing by and say hi. I'm also co-host of Community Pulse with PJ. It's a monthly podcast about all the things that community managers and professionals care about, from analytics and ROI, and how to maintain our personal lives, to building communities and growing communities, things like that. And lastly, I help manage a thing called the Evangelist Collective, which is Slack community for community professionals. So when I'm not doing all of those things, I live in San Francisco. I used to refer to my apartment as an expensive storage unit due to how often I was on the road and traveling, but I'm lucky enough to actually be there in person most of the time these days. So this picture is of Emperor and I at the top of a place called Tank Hill. As you can see, I'm not someone who looks like they need a service dog. Which is good, because Ember doesn't look like a service dog. So we fit really well together. So let me explain a little bit of my background and how Ember became a service dog for me and why he's such a huge help for me. This is a picture of me when I was 3 years old, and I've got the pigtails with the yarn and the striped kitty dress, and super excited about that striped kitty dress. It was one of my favorites. And I've got a medical alert bracelet on my left wrist, which I still have today and I've worn ever since. So I was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes when I was 2 years old, and I don't remember not having diabetes, and I don't remember the moment when I was diagnosed, but it's funny how much this single fact has defined my life and defined my timeline. There's no doubt my life would be drastically different without it. So what is diabetes? I don't know if you can see slides and the meme that's behind me. There's just a little bit of confusion these days around what diabetes or diabetes actually is and what it isn't. So a few facts about it to help clear up some of that. First of all, 29 million Americans have some form of diabetes, whether that's type 1, type 2, gestational, but only 5% of us are type 1. So for obvious reasons, the majority of the research and the knowledge and the information that's passed around has to do with type 2, because that's the most common. So it leads to a lot of misconceptions and general lack of knowledge around it. So first of all, it is not caused by excessive weight or not taking care of yourself. Also, it's not caused by your parents feeding you too much sugar when you're a kid, despite what one of my college roommates liked to tell me. Just fun conversations to have at 2 o'clock in the morning. Also, it's not preventable. So it is an autoimmune disease. Your body essentially decides that it's not working the way that it should and starts just killing things off. It is chronic also. So while it's treatable, it doesn't have a cure. So this picture on the left, which you can't see very well, unfortunately, gives you an idea of what this treatment on a daily basis looks like. It's lancets and finger pricks and insulin pumps or shots for some people, continuous glucose monitoring systems, emergency supplies, and in my case, a dog who alerts me my blood sugar is heading towards low and I need to take a break. Picture on the right shows some of the devices that I wear on a daily basis. I have an insulin pump that delivers a certain amount of insulin per hour, and I give myself more when I have food or my blood sugar is running high, and a continuous glucose monitoring system that tracks my blood sugar on a regular basis so that I can see the patterns of how I'm doing. So in its most basic terms, this all means that I've probably pricked my finger about 60,000 times to record the amount of sugar in my bloodstream throughout my life up till this point. I've done around 8,000 shots of insulin prior to getting my insulin pump, and since getting my insulin pump, I've converted probably around 1,500 new pump sites. That's not to talk about the number of carbohydrates I've counted over the years, or how quickly and easily I learned my 15, 13, 17 times tables when I was really little to be able to calculate all of those things out. So diabetes sucks, and the treatment of it sucks, but it doesn't keep me from doing a lot of the things that I really love. It doesn't keep me from playing with my niece, doesn't keep me from going hiking and climbing, doesn't keep me from indoor skydiving, which is awesome. You should totally try it. Talk to me about it later. Anyways, so I've always been independent and stubborn and determined to do things as much as I can on my own, partly because of my upbringing, partly because of my grandma, partly because that's just what happens when you have a chronic disease. And then Ember came along. About 8 years ago, I got him as a pet. No intent of having him travel with me as a service dog, no intent of anything other than I want a dog and this would be fun. And about 3 years after I got him, he started waking me up in the middle of the night. And every time he would wake me up, within about 20, 25 minutes, I would start to feel really crappy. And I'd do a blood test and realize that my blood sugar was really low. And so finally, third or fourth time, I started putting pieces together and went, okay, he's alerting me. I don't know how he's doing this. I don't know if this is a thing that actually happens on a regular basis, but this is what he's doing and there's something I can do about it. So long story short, I talked to my doctor and now he travels with me everywhere. He's a registered service dog for me. Worked with him a lot on how to be around other people, how to travel, how to behave in public, things like that. And bonus, he ends up being an easy way for me to be found at conferences. So, all this is great. It's a lot of good information for you to know in general. But how does this affect all of you, other than getting some extra dog love at conferences that I'm happy to be at? A few more numbers for you. Let's pivot for a second. So, first number, 7%. It's the number of people in the population that admit, which is a key point, that they struggle with some sort of mental disability or illness, including depression. Diabetics are 3 times more likely to struggle with depression due to the mental and emotional toll from dealing with chronic disease. So it's something that I have to be really conscious of and aware of on a regular basis. But this 49% is the number that I really want to focus on. This is a huge number, bigger than either of those that are up there already. And this is the percentage of people in tech, particularly managers, leaders, founders of companies, who struggle with depression and something closely related, which you all might be familiar with, burnout. So this is a really, really big number. That's a big problem. It's not okay. So, fine. If you're not a manager, founder, leader, those things in your company, you might be sitting there going, oh, well, that's not an issue that I have to deal with. And that's fair. You don't have as much pressure as some of those people do. But all of us here do work in tech. So I did a quick Google search for the term burnout in tech culture. Can anyone see what the number at the top of the screen says? 2 million. Slight problem. And granted, let's assume that some of those aren't relevant topics, right? Let's assume that some of those are just people who have tagged articles with popular terms and things like that. But even if you take only 10% of that, that's still 200,000 results. That's still a huge number. It's still a big problem. So, for those of you who are giving me this look right now, I don't want to be a downer. I don't want to predict that everyone in this room is going to go through burnout. I don't want to say that we're all going to wind up depressed, because I don't think that's the case. But I am saying that there's a problem in our industry, and I think we should be the ones to start to fix it. So how do we do that? I think the first thing we need to do is figure out what causes burnout in the first place. So there's two books that I'll be referencing today. I put the information up here. I'm happy to tweet about them afterwards as well. They're both fantastic resources, and I encourage you to pick them up when you have a chance. The first one is called Overwhelmed, How to Work, Play, and that should not have rotated, sorry about that. How to Work, Love, and Play When No One Has the Time. And the other is The Truth About Burnout by Christina Maslach. So Truth About Burnout gives some basic causes of burnout, and they resonate pretty well with everything I've heard and felt. I'm not going to cover all of them today, but I encourage you to pick up a copy of the book. The first one is a lack of control. And I think this gift explains it pretty well. We start out really excited and passionate and intense about this new hobby. We try to conquer it, and we try again and again. But unless we have the right mentors, the right company, the right situations, we wind up simply hiding, waiting for all the pieces to fall. And turns out, a lot of us tend to pursue different hobbies as a result. third causes of burnout that Christina Maslach mentions are unfairness and insufficient reward. So I'm sure you all know someone, or maybe it's you, who's the go-to person for everyone's questions. You're the person who always picks up the code review, who always mentors the new people, who always helps the new employee learn the ropes. And that's great. There's nothing wrong with that. But what happens when that starts to feel unfair or unbalanced? What happens when the rewards that you're getting just aren't enough? There's been a lot of articles in Forbes and Entrepreneur, Applied Social Psychology, a whole bunch of different sites lately, that state past a certain point, money is not a motivator. And I know someone mentioned yesterday that a lot of us have higher salaries than pretty much anyone else in other industries. But that only gets us so far. That only pays off so much. And it hits this point where it's just, you can't pay me enough to continue to do the things that you're asking me to do. The next reason for burnout is work overload. So in a conversation with a close friend last year, I told her this. I said, it's the constant overwhelmedness factor, the overflowing inbox, the never being in my San Francisco home long enough to actually clean and get things organized the way I want them to be, the to-do list that's 5 pages long and only ever seems to grow, not shrink, and the burden of feeling like I'm the only one who can do all of these things. The always being on at events, which isn't fake, and I love it, but it's draining. The physical exhaustion from not getting enough sleep consistently, and from my blood sugars not being as under control as I would like. And also, the guilt that comes with all of the above. So these are things that I've heard repeatedly from a lot of people who deal with burnout. And Kanban boards and backlogs and things like that help a lot. But what about when those backlogs are overflowing and the teams are too lean to actually work as a lean team? Last reason I'm going to cover today is lack of community. So when we spend so much time investing in work, in our code, in learning new skills, we sometimes fail to invest in our personal lives. And we start to drift away from the circle of people that are closest to us. As our friend Jason's tweet says, community is those people who come looking for you when you don't show up. I think all of us need to find that group of people and those people in our lives. So, by this point, you're either looking at me like this, or maybe like this, realizing that you're either on the road to burnout, or have been there for some time already, or know people who are burned out as well. By the way, sorry if you've come to the resolution of the recognition during my talk so far that you are burned out or you're down that road. I apologize, but it'll get better, I promise. So now that we've recognized what causes burnout, next thing I want to cover is how do we prevent it? And what can we do if we're already there? First thing is making sure that we're taking care of ourselves first and foremost. Most of you probably can't see this slide, but it's Alf, if you remember the character Alf. And someone's putting an oxygen mask on him, and they already have their oxygen mask on. So airlines are constantly reminding us to put our own oxygen masks on first. This isn't because they want children or people with disabilities to go without oxygen for longer, obviously, but it's because if we aren't getting oxygen ourselves, we can't be expected to help others. So putting on our own oxygen mask first, aka taking care of ourselves, setting aside time just for us, being selfish, because it's not a bad thing sometimes, is essential. So set that time aside, or else you're going to be short-selling your community, you're going to be short-selling your company, and most of all, you're going to be short-selling yourself. One of those ways that you can make sure you're getting enough oxygen is stepping away from your laptop. Everyone should be able to carefully throw your laptop across the room sometimes and just close it and leave it there for a while. And it's hard. I get it. Part of why we do what we do is because we love solving problems. We love helping other people. We love being there for other people and being there for our team. But when we find ourselves working longer and longer hours in order to meet unrealistic deadlines, or review just one more pull request, or figure out just one more bug, there's a problem. A good friend of mine has a sign up on his desk that says, is the world on fire? If no, stop. If yes, call a firefighter. And there's a couple important principles here. First of all, we should not be expected to be online at all times, no matter what. And if this is the expectation, you need to sit down and have a serious conversation with your manager. This should not be the case, and there are no exceptions to that. Doesn't matter how small or large your team is. Doesn't matter if you're the only one who can fix that problem. It doesn't matter if you're the only person on your team who's qualified for certain things. And yes, there's going to be times every once in a while when we have to stay up late fixing a problem, or when you'll get a page in the middle of the night, or things like that. But it should not be the norm. And if it is, talk to your manager. And if that doesn't change it, talk to people here today, because I'm fairly certain there's people here that are hiring. Secondly, there are other people who will step up and take responsibility for the things that you're doing when you can't. make sure that I don't have access to certain things at work so that I can't be responsible for those things. I don't have access to our support ticketing system because it's not my job. We have a whole community service department dedicated to that. I actively make sure I'm not on sales calls because, again, it's not my job. We have technical sales folks who are supposed to be on those calls. And if I am allowing myself to be on those things, if I am allowing myself to pick up the problems that everyone else is asking me to, I'm giving people the impression that I am the only person who can help, and I'm essentially teaching them to take advantage of me rather than allowing them to reach out to the people who can help them the most. Next thing, learn to say no. A lot of us really struggle with this word, and it's not that difficult of a word to say, but situationally, it can be hard to bring up. So the easiest way to learn to say no, get your manager's buy-in that you have to run things past them before you commit to projects outside of your department. Make them the bad guy. It's what they're there for. You are an extremely valuable part of their team, and it's their job to protect you. Also, be okay with saying no to your personal life. Occasionally, you need to take time off just to focus on you. Speaking of personal time, use your calendar. Really use it for two different things. First of all, time box your projects. So when you know that you have a big work project coming up or something that you really have to focus on, make sure you set that time aside on your calendar so that people can't put meetings on there or people know that you're going to be unavailable. And then let your team know that you're going to be offline or that you need to be on Do Not Disturb for a while. And again, if something happens, they'll likely be able to fix it. If you're the only person who can, they can reach out to you then. Secondly, keep things on your calendar so you can't skip them, including vacation. Plan for it. I have a practice of always having a vacation on my calendar at some point. So when I come back from a vacation, if I don't have another vacation coming up on my calendar, even if it's just a long weekend, I make sure I schedule one. This keeps you with something to look forward to. Keeps you able to focus on what you're doing because you know that you're going to have some time to relax coming up. But then also, when you're on vacation, be on vacation. If you use Slack or HipChat at work, make sure you change your username before you go to say out of office or PTO or something like that so that people know you're not available. Make sure you set up your email bounce back so that, again, people know you won't be responding for a few days. Give yourself those extra boundaries so that people are aware that you're gone and can't be reached. I mentioned the book earlier called Overwhelmed, and the author realized as she was writing the book and interviewing people for it that planning for leisure time takes effort. Here's a quote from the book. She says, "I realized I just kept putting it off, like I was waiting to reach some tipping point. Like I just finished picking all the weeds, chopping the bamboo, cleaning up the crayons and shark teeth and math papers, buying more cat food." She goes on and on. Then I could sit down and read a book, as if leisure was something I needed to earn. And she says something else that I think can resonate with all of us. "Even when I seemed to just have some free time, it was often for such a short period that I was at a loss for what to do with it. So I just went back to the next item on the to-do list instead." We need to learn to put down our to-do list and to take that time for ourselves and plan for vacation or plan for a break. Even if it means spending a little bit of extra money to pay someone else to take care of planning it, or taking a staycation when you'd rather go somewhere else, or just taking a day off to lay around home and be leisurely. But plan for that time or else it simply won't happen. At the very least, I would posit we all have 4 hours every 2 weeks that we can take out of our normal workday to take a step back, see the forest as well as the trees, and decompress a little bit. Don't believe me? I don't blame you. Totally understand how busy we all are. But let me explain. So first of all, keep in mind, again, totally understand we all have a lot of things on our plate. We all have a lot of pressure at work. We all have a hard time getting everything done every week. But one of my good friends, Jay Paul Reed, came to me a while back with this idea of 4 hour decompress. It's a time to reflect, evaluate, and recenter our goals and ideas before tackling another work week. And here's the thing. It's only 4 hours every other week. 4 hours out of 8 weeks. 4 hours that will make you stronger, more effective, more efficient with your work, and more motivated to do your work on a regular basis. It can also lead to great ideas of how to lead and grow your team as you take the time to step back and see the forest as well as the trees. So here's a little idea of what it involves. First of all, find a location, a place where you can relax, get comfortable, spread out, dig into whatever you're going to be doing. Whether that's a coffee shop, a library, a hiking trail, the pool, wherever you're most comfortable, find that spot. And during that first hour, deliberately disconnect from your normal day-to-day work. So if you need to wrap up a few things before you can focus, go ahead and do that. If you need to spread out your equipment, cool, whatever you need to do in order to disconnect from your laptop for a few hours. I usually wrap up a few things and then go for a run or a walk to kind of get myself into that mindset and get my brain off of work things. So then during second and third hours, find something that's constructive and helpful, but allows you to stay disconnected from your everyday work. So for me, sometimes it's digging into Codecademy or brushing up on lessons for coding. Sometimes it's reading the latest business or work-related book that I'm happening to be reading at the time, or whiteboarding the latest topic that I've been looking into. And then lastly, as you wind down from that thing that you've been doing in those couple hours, that last hour brings it all back together. So I'll usually journal a little bit about what I read or learned, how I'm feeling about work, how I'm feeling about burnout, make a list of things that I want to talk about when I'm back in the office, and then pack up and head back home. Next thing, when you're sick, be sick, and let yourself be sick, and don't be online. I'm really bad at this one, but seriously, take advantage of sick days and vacation time, whatever it's called in your company, and use it. So when you wake up not feeling well, take the day off and don't be online. You'll be amazed at how much more quickly you heal. And speaking of healing, when you're needing mental care, get it. Mental illness, depression, anxiety, all of these things are normal, and it's mental health, which means it's health, which means it's important, just as important as your physical health. So just like a broken hand or an infection, it's a medical condition. Don't let anyone tell you differently. Start by taking a look at your company insurance policy. A lot of insurance policies allow for a small number of psychologists or psychiatric visits at no charge. I have a friend at a former company who used to just go find a therapist that he hadn't seen before, a psychologist, psychiatrist he hadn't seen before. And we had 4 free visits a year under our insurance policy. And he'd just pick a month and say, cool, I'm going to book 4 visits with this psychiatrist. And I'm just going to talk to them and get their advice and ramble about whatever's on my chest and get things off my chest and kind of get a pulse of how I'm doing. And it doesn't cost me anything. So take advantage of those things. Also, find your own communities. I mentioned earlier that one of the things that we lose track of is our own personal communities, our own personal hobbies. So do what you can to invest in those communities. This is a picture of San Francisco, and it's kind of cartoon-like, but it's divided into all these different neighborhoods and the hobbies and the things that people do. And I know it's a difficult thing to do sometimes, if you're not as willing to invest or not as able to invest in those things. I'll give you a hint, though. Meetup is for more than just tech talks. Everyone knows that. It has a lot of hobby groups, has a lot of adventuring groups, hiking groups, outdoors groups, things like that as well. It's a great tool to be able to connect with people in your city outside of tech. Also, find places that connect with you, where you feel better, where you can feel at peace, where when you know that you're stressed out, things that you can go do to allow yourself to decompress a little bit. So, who am I to be saying all of these things? Obviously, I'm not a doctor, not a medical professional, haven't studied psychology or psychiatry or any other line of thought along those lines, but I do know what I'm talking about to a certain extent. Almost 2 years ago now, I burned out really hard, and I'm better now, not 100%, but I'm better, and part of the reason it took me as long as it did to start recovering from that was because I didn't do a lot of these things I've been talking about today. I didn't take care of myself. I didn't reach out to my community. I was really scared about the repercussions, and I was terrified of the perception, but that hurt me more because it forced me to keep going and to keep doing the things that I was doing before. So these days, I'm lucky enough to have a community, both professionally and personally, who I know will keep an eye out for me and check in on me. One of my coworkers who's actually here today will ask me on a regular basis, like, there's a lot on your plate. You doing okay? Maybe take a step back. So it's awesome to have those people around me. And I say I'm lucky enough, but it didn't come from luck. It took from me working to build those relationships and working really hard to have that community. And I have to continually work at it, but it's worth it. So take a moment and look around you, because everyone in this room understands the stresses of being in the tech industry. Everyone understands the difficulties that we have keeping up with everything that's going on. Everyone knows that you need a community to rally around you. So as you're attending events, as you're at meetups, as you're doing various things throughout your day and meeting new people, don't be afraid to say, hey, I'm a little burned out, or I'm a little overwhelmed, and I need some support right now. Because more often than not, the people who are around you will next to each other. We might not all work next to each other, but we're all online. We all, most of us have an online presence or on Slack channels or IRC or Twitter, and being able to reach out into the internet void and say, hey, having a rough day, or I need some help, or does anyone understand these types of situations, and getting that support in return is huge. And don't underestimate the value of that. Also, don't underestimate the value of you. We're valuable, we're important, we're influential, we're worth taking care of, even if we're the ones that are having to take care of ourselves. Quoting one more time from Overwhelmed, the author finds herself talking to Danish women who seemingly have all the time in the world for leisure and feel no guilt about it, but also manage to get a lot of things done in a timely fashion. So the woman that she's speaking with says, having leisure time for myself isn't something we even have to discuss. It's just natural. The author replies, you don't feel guilty or selfish or that you're neglecting your children, worried about the to-do list at work. The woman gave me a blank look. I think Danish women, she finally said, perhaps know their worth. And I would argue that we need to know our worth as well. So I talked about who I am, why I'm here today, my journey with diabetes and Ember, as well as my struggle with burnout. And we talked about you, some of the numbers around depression and burnout in people in tech, as well as some of the specifics about causes burnout. And we talked about what to do about burnout, both how to prevent it and how to slowly recover from it. And it is a slow recovery. I mentioned earlier, I'm doing better, and I am. But I'm probably 70% most days, and that means the 7 days are awesomely productive and I feel really good about it, and every once in a while, one is horrifically bad. And most days, they're somewhere in the middle, and it's a process. But most importantly, I know that it's real. I know that it's a process. I know that that's okay, and I know that I don't need to be ashamed of it. And I know I have a community to help me as well. I'm going to close with this one last quote, and it was interesting to me as I was listening to Brian's talk. He's here, but as I was listening to him yesterday, he was talking about passions and things that we're involved in, and I think it really applies to this. It says, passion, which could be your job, your open source projects, your side hobbies, whatever, is what drives you and gives your life meaning. Obsession is what happens when you're fixated on something, forsaking all the rest. Understand the difference between passion and obsession to change your thoughts and actions. Find balance by cultivating other interests offline. So let's remember to be awesome. Let's be incredible, let's be passionate about what we're doing, but let's be balanced about it as well. If you have any questions,